Good morning and praise the Lord. Good morning and praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, let's clap our hands. Hallelujah. We are grateful to be here, thankful for another day that we can come and worship together in corporate worship in unity. And we just bless God. We bless the name of the Lord. So we send greetings in the precious name of Jesus to his people. Amen.
Amen.
He's a good God. We love him. I am so thankful to be alive and well in my right mind. I thank God for an opportunity to give him praise and glory and honor. I thank God for a church family that I can come to and I can love on them. They love on me, and I appreciate that. That's a beautiful support, amen, that some may not have, so I'm thankful for it. Thankful for all of you. Thankful for all of you making it important in your day to be here. So at this time, we're going to ask Bishop Abram if he would come and open us up in prayer. We know that we men should always pray. Amen. Prayer is essential and it's important. It's a way that we can talk to God. He can talk back to us. Amen. Bishop.
If you would all just bow your heads, excuse me, and if you can stand, it's good to stand, amen, in reverence and honor to the Lord. Father God, we want to thank you this morning for waking us up, starting us on our day. Yes. We thank you that you're mindful of us as your children.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, we're so grateful for this great salvation you've provided for us through your son, Jesus. And so we pray for those who are hurting today. There's some that have been going through tests and trials, and we ask that you minister to them, and not only you, but as your people, that you would, through discernment and the giftings of the Spirit, that we will be able to pray and intercede and touch those that are hurting this morning. We pray for those who lost loved ones and those who may be having difficulties on their jobs, that you would move in their behalf in the name of Jesus. And we lift up all the students to you, our young people, that they will turn to you because the word of the Lord. And the preacher said, remember now, thou creator, in the days of your youth, before the time draws nigh when you say, I don't have any pleasure in them. When the body deteriorates and when things begin to happen, hallelujah. And so, God, we pray not only for the young people, but for our government, our president, his cabinet, other leaders of nations, that you would remember them also, that we'll have a peaceable life. And, Lord, we pray for our services, that you'll continue to bless Pastor John, Lady Lynetta, as they minister and carry on this work in the name of Jesus. We love you, Lord, and we just are so grateful for life, health, and strength, and the necessities that you have provided for us. For Jesus, you said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, what we would eat and our shelter, clothing and these things. We don't have to worry about them because you are our provider, and we bless your name. We glorify you today. We lift your name on high. Hallelujah. And Lord, we ask that you would encourage hearts, amen, to be saved. Holy Spirit, you deal with them, amen, because you know it's going to take the Lord to draw people. We can witness, but it'll take your spirit to draw people unto thee. So we love you, Lord. We praise you for another day. And we want to do that which is pleasing in your sight all the days of our life. And we know when this life is over, whether through the rapture or death, we know we have a better resurrection. We'll be with you throughout eternity. And this is our hope. Amen. The hope of a believer. And we glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen. that prayer at this time. We'd ask Minister Darnett if she'll come with the scripture. Let's receive her by saying amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord and good morning.
Praise the Lord.
I'm going to read. I was thinking about the prayer of Jabez this morning, and it's just one scripture. 1 Chronicles 4 and 4 and verse 10. I'm sorry, chapter 4, verse 10, one verse. 1 Chronicles 4 and 10. When you have it, you can stand and we can just read this one verse together. And Jabez called on his, we can read this all together. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, Oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my host, and that thine hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, and it may not grieve me. And God granted him that which he requested. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the blessed word.
Amen.
God granted. God granted. Hallelujah. God granted that request. And I want to encourage each and every one of you that God is able to grant you your request.
Yes.
We just have to make it known unto him. You know, prayer, as we talked earlier, you know, we quote the scripture often. We know the word that prayer is always in order. Mm-hmm. So we just have to cry out to him, and that's what Jabez did.
Yes.
And just remember those things, that God is a prayer answering God. Mm-hmm. If my people, which are called by his name,
yes,
would humble themselves and seek my face, pray, seek my face. That, you know, God will honor your request. So remember that God is faithful. At this time, we're going to have meet and greet and take a few moments to go across the aisle or to your neighbor behind you or in front of you and encourage them, bless them, say something that'll bless them along their week. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank God for meet and greet. Let's give the Lord another hand praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are welcome in this place. The word of the day is power. How many know that there's power in the name of Jesus?
Amen.
How many know there's healing in the name of Jesus? Hallelujah. Thank God for the power. 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear," amen, "but of power and of love and of a sound mind." How many want a sound mind? Always, amen. Self-discipline, sound mind, doing things in decency and in order. Praise God for that. So I just praise God for his grace and his mercy, for the power that God has given us once we received his spirit. Amen. We have power. How many are powerful in the Lord? God is a good God. He's faithful and he is just. Amen. Amen. We're getting ready to prepare for praise and worship, so we want you to praise God with us. Exalt his name. Glorify him. Amen. Has he been good to you?
Amen.
Has he been good to you? Amen. Hallelujah. He's been better than good to me. And I praise God for that. I praise God because he's a faithful God.
Yes.
He is an awesome God. Mm-hmm. I know we were talking about prayer just a little bit ago, and I prayed and God honored my request.
Yes.
Amen. I prayed for so many things, and God has just answered so many down through the years. I prayed for a good husband, and God delivered. I prayed for a good job, and he blessed me with that. I prayed for just a good life, amen, to enjoy this life, and God is doing just that. So whatever the desires of your heart are, make them known. Amen? Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. Let's give him a hand clap of praise. Let's go ahead and get on our feet and just begin to worship the Lord. Has he not been good to you? Man, I tell you, this week has just been, well, I tell you, God, you ever just have God be so good? You know, his goodness, he says he'll cause his goodness to chase after you, right? The goodness of the Lord. Man, I tell you, it is overwhelming. It really, really is. And I was just telling a friend of mine, I said, you know, God has been so good to me.
Amen.
The word says it's the grace of God.
Yes.
Grace is goodness.
Yes.
It's the goodness of God that caused men to repent.
Yes.
You ever had God be so good to you? You're just like, you know what? God's been too good to me. You know, it's just some things you just want to do differently because God's been so good. You ever have a good parent or just someone that's just been good to you, a good friend, you know, and that's a human goodness, you know it's flawed. But the goodness of God, God is perfect in his goodness. I mean, he's good even when you don't even realize it's good, you know. And so I just think about how good God has been to me. And it just, I mean, it is just overwhelming. It is overwhelming. So I just, Lord, we just worship you. We thank you. Lord, we magnify you, Lord God. You are worthy to be praised. There is none like you. Just begin to worship the Lord. He inhabits the praises of his people. So just begin to worship him. Lord, we worship you. Lord, you are worthy of the praise, the honor, the glory. There is none like you. None like you, Lord God. Searched all over, right? We searched all over. We did, whether we realized it or not. We searched all over. Lord God, we looked in relationships. We looked at jobs. We've looked, Father, in every way, Lord God, but there is none like you. None like you, Lord God. And I thank you that you brought us to the end of ourselves, Lord God. And we realize, Lord God, that it's been you all along, Lord God. It's been you all along, Lord God. You have chased after us, Lord God. You have loved us recklessly, Lord God. And so, oh, Lord, you found us, Lord God. Lord, you said, while we were yet sinners, Lord, you found us in our sin, in our brokenness, at the lowest place, Lord God. And I thank you, Lord God, you lifted us in that moment, Lord God. Lord, I just thank you. You are good. You're the only truth in the whole universe. There is none like you, Lord God. None like you. None like you. You are worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We exalt you over every situation. We exalt you over every concern, every care, every worry, every need, Lord God. Father God, you are more than enough. Lord God, you are more than enough. Lord, satisfy us. Lord, satisfy us. Whatever it is that we're longing for, Lord God, satisfy us, Lord God. Satisfy us, Lord. Father, satisfy us, Lord God. Father, satisfy us, Lord God. We thank you. The Lord gave me such an awesome word this week. I've been so busy. You know, I have a home that's under construction right now. I got 2 bathrooms, a contractor. There's just so much stuff going on, good stuff, but it's just so busy. And I reached out to one of my professors, and I was just letting him know what was going on. And he said something to me. It didn't register until recently. He said, you know, this might be your best grade yet. And, you know, we kind of like to, the best grade to us is an A, right? Because that's like the best grade. And I'm thinking, like, well, if it ain't an A, it ain't the best grade. And he was just like, well, this might be your best grade yet. And I was just like, well, how do you figure? He said, well, I mean, he said, it's the best grade because consider all of the obstacles. Consider everything you had to go through to get it. And God, yesterday I was talking to my mentor, Margo Middleton, and I was telling her that, and the Lord just had, you know, just started to minister that to me. He said, this is your best season yet. This is a word for somebody. This is your best season yet. Because of everything you had to do to persevere to get here. This is your best season yet. Sometimes we look at the grade. We're looking at how it feels. We're looking at, you know, what did I accomplish? You know, we're looking at the, you know, the outcome in terms of just, you know, well, did it feel good? And did I get the money? Or did I get the job? Or did it, you know, did I accomplish this great thing? But we are here. We persevered. We kept showing up. And that's what it is. The race is not given to the swift. It's the one who endures. So it's what we persevere through. It's the press that is the success. It's actually the pressing. It's what he's building up in us. You know what I'm saying? He's building us up in our most holy faith. Amen. That's really what it is. Amen. It's everything we went through to get here. Yes. And this is your best season yet. It may not feel like it. You may feel like you're failing. You may feel like, man, I'm at the lowest place in my faith. I felt like that sometimes. Yeah. I felt like I've been at more successful places in my faith where I prayed more and I had deeper devotion. And man, I was in my word at, you know, I spent 30 whole minutes, I spent a whole hour. I had a wonderful, saturated worship session. And then you go through seasons where it's just like, man, I just, you know, I'm in the car. Oh, Lord, my God, you know, Lord, man, I'm driving. I just forgot to pray. You know, just didn't even get any time. You just feel like you're in a low place, you know. And you're getting, I mean, just look, right, left, knocked. I mean, you're just getting ping-ponged around. And you just feel like, I mean, it's like, my God, you know. You almost feel like you've taken steps back. But God reminded me, he said, this is actually your best season yet. He said, this is your best grade yet because of what he's building up in me, because you don't know what it takes to keep showing up when you don't even feel good about where you're at. To keep showing up by faith and believing, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And that's not predicated on how I feel. That's predicated on what God said. I approach the throne only on the basis of what Jesus did, not on the basis of what of the great prayers that I prayed, or how, you know, deep I was this week, or how successful I was. Yes, those things are important, right? Those are the byproducts of our faith. But sometimes we just, like John has been reminding us, right? We have these three, right? We were saved. We were saved, right? When Jesus died and he rose, we rose, yes. Right? We are positionally saved. Yes. And then we are being saved. Yes. And this being saved season feels so uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. It feels very uncomfortable. It does. It feels raggedy sometimes. It's very messy. It's uncomfortable. No, seriously. I feel like I'm walking around with one sock down and a shoe off and my wig twisted to the side. And I just, it feels a hot mess. It really does. It feels a hot mess. You know, but thank God people don't see me that way. But it feels that way. It really does. It feels that way. But I thank you that I'll be glorified.
Hallelujah.
Based on what Jesus has declared.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? That we are victorious.
Yes.
And so that's what God reminded me. He said, you just keep, you know, remember who you are. Keep showing up. Keep declaring what I said.
Amen.
And this is my best season yet.
Yes.
Because it has fortified me.
Yes.
It has fortified me.
That's
what it has fortified me. And that's what John reminded me of. And I it was hard for me to embrace that. He said, it's because of your faithfulness, sis. And I was like, faithfulness, shoot. Really? No, it is. And it's his faith. It's his faith. It's his faith. Yes. Yeah. It's been a blessing. Sis, I didn't even mean to go through all of that. I apologize. But it was such a blessing.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Praise team, we can come. Thank you for those words of encouragement, and we just want you to worship with us. Come to praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I just want to.
I
Week on the Christian liberties and the freedoms that we have in Jesus. And that one thing I've learned is that all the things that maybe you wanted to do way back when, maybe you did want to go party and drink all night and do all kinds of things, I learned that's not what I wanted to do once I found Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. There's a freedom in Jesus.
Yes.
That you want to do what's right and what's holy. And what's a blessing to you, not things that will bring condemnation and conviction on you. Hallelujah. Things that make you wake up and say, well, guess what? I think I did all right. I might not have been perfect, but I did all right. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. As Minister Diana was talking just a little bit ago about the best grade yet, I thought about this week. There was a lady I train at my job, and there was a lady who came into my class, and I was a little concerned about her because I didn't feel like she was comprehending everything that I was trying to teach her. And I know some things that you all can relate, maybe even as parents, or things that you've done down through your life. When you teach somebody something and they get it, you feel good about it, right? But when they're not getting it, you wonder if there's a disconnect or something's going on.
Yes.
I did feel like there was a language barrier. And for the first time in about 6 years that I've been on this particular job, I had to not give her a passing grade. And I felt a little bad. Yeah. But at the same time, I thought to myself, I'd rather tell her that she did not do well than pass her on and do her a disservice, right? Sometimes we just have to tell people the truth. But the scripture says, tell the people truth and love. Amen? And so I told her, you did not pass. And I said, please don't be discouraged. Keep trying if this is really what you want. And you know what she said to me? I am not discouraged. And I feel good about where I'm at. Because she had made progress. She's not from here. But I thank God that she's going to keep on trying. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So don't feel like that you are failing. Keep trying. Keep moving. Keep moving in the right direction. And I believe that's also what Minister Diana was saying. Keep doing it. It is your best grade yet, but you're doing good. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. At this time, we are going to call on our pastor, Pastor John Lee, if he would come at this time and bring us the word of God. Let's receive him by saying amen.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you this morning. Glad you're here. We thank God for just another opportunity to worship this morning. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in the book of 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. We're going to do a little teaching this morning. If you recall last week, this is Communion Sunday, so toward the end of the sermon, we'll all come up to the first few rows, and we're going to have communion today. Holy sacrament, commanded by God, not as a suggestion, as a commandment. So the Bible says that often as you do it, do it in remembrance of me.
Yes.
It didn't give us a strict regimen of weekly. They believe in the Catholic Church they may do it every month or week or something. But it wants us to do it regularly and with great implications of why we do it regularly. So we're going to teach a little bit. If you have your Bibles, if there is a red Bible, I'll be reading from the ESV this morning. I'm going to come down here and share this morning. Like Bible study.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 11:26. All that we do for a reason. I've heard some people say that they would quit their current job if it wasn't for the benefits. So we all have secondary reasons why we do what we do, and then we also have main reasons why we do what we do. Amen. Let me help you out. Some of us go to a job that we do not like because of the children that we love. That's the main reason. It may pay well, but that's not the main reason why we go. We go because we have kids that we love that we are going to take care of. Come Christmas time, Grandma's going to have some gifts on that table. Can I get amen? I'm a little warm. I didn't turn these up this morning. But everything that we do in life, we have a reason to do it. A man goes out, he buys a ring for a woman. He don't know everything about that ring and the cuts and how many carats is on there. Because knowing all that is not the main reason why he bought the ring anyway. He bought the ring as a symbol, that round oval as a symbol of eternity, is eternal love for her. That was the main reason.
Yes.
He may have got it on discount, bless his heart. And there's nothing wrong with that. But the main reason why he did it is because he loved her.
Yes.
In every avenue of our lives, we pursue the things that we love. And for some of us, this painting, Brother Andrew, a few years ago gave me a wonderful painting that I still have in my home. He has a passion for it. And when you have a passion for something, you don't necessarily have to be paid to do it. Amen. And I encourage you this morning, just from a practical level, to pursue something that you have a passion for. Life is short. Solomon said it was a vapor. It's here today and gone tomorrow. The Bible says that a man is born of a woman, his days are short and full of trouble. So I back you up this morning, you minister, and that's what the Bible says. It is full of trouble. But yeah, we rejoice. But when it comes to our Christian faith, it is no different. We do things in the church and in service to God for various reasons. Remember, Ephesians, he gives us the list of the offices in the church that have been longstanding from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Mm-hmm. And he lets us know that we do those things, and we have those positions in place for the edification of the body, and for the building up of the body.
Yes.
You can't be built up without the teaching of the apostles. You can forget it. Without the writings of the prophets, you can forget it. And on this side of the cross, without a pastor, a teacher, an evangelist to give you the present, that rental word, you're not going to be fully edified. There's an onus for me to go into that Bible and get something on my own. But today you need a pastor.
Amen.
And if the pastor is not me, that's just fine. But you need a pastor. God said someone who can feed you with knowledge and understanding.
Amen.
Can we get amen this morning?
Amen.
And even a pastor needs a pastor.
Yes.
And I have several people, including the bishop of this house, and a founder of this church, who is always there to help me. I don't feel like there's anything that I can't tell him. And that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Because most of them don't have that. So I encourage you to reach out and just remember the corporate need of the body of Christ. All of us have a place. And all of us have something that God wants us to be doing. But we find out that our passions are tied to our gifts. And our gifts are tied to your calling. Never forget that. What is your calling? Well, brother, sister, what is your gift? Because God has gifted you for your calling.
Yes.
Ain't no need to send you off by twos and shaking dust off your feet without a gift.
Right.
Without something you're going to be able to impart to people as you go along your way.
Mm-hmm.
So the Bible says God has given each man a gift according to the Holy Spirit, the administration of the Spirit. Through faith we have a gift. That gift may not be stirred up. That gift may not even be known yet. There's a time to walk when God starts revealing stuff to you that you may not have known for a time. Amen. But those things give us joy, and they give us a passion as we work within the body of Christ. And it is something that is solely and uniquely your responsibility to stir up your own gift.
Yes.
I can stir up your gift. You have to stir up your own gift. I can teach, but I can't walk your calling. You have to walk your calling. I can serve in church, but I can't serve in the church for you.
Yes.
You have to serve in the church.
Yes.
And the church is not necessarily this building, although it sure keeps warm. It's nice to have one.
Yes.
And there's those people who have a jaded view of what the church is. They believe just in the mystical church, which is all the saints from now all down through time. But there is a physical church you ought to go to. Jesus went to church. He worshiped. He was faithful to the temple. And he, as a forerunner, was, the apostles were, the first early Christians in the church were, that it is sort of insane for me to say, I won't be a part of this. Even with the teachings of Hebrews, it says, do not forsake the assembly of yourselves together, as some do. Don't be some. Whatever happens, don't be some. Things that happen in the confines of a church where if you're not really rooted in the word, the smallest thing can make you stay at home.
Amen.
And remember, this is not about other people. This is about you personally.
Amen.
This is about your need for the word, your need for corporate worship. And as God sharpens us one another, remember iron sharpens iron, then you become sharp.
Amen.
You become sharp. And a lot of times we have blunt blades in the body of Christ because they don't buy into the principle of iron sharpening iron, the edification of saints one to another.
Yes.
Last week, we talked about the importance of communion. We was going to talk on it. So that's the way we're going to do today. If you have the ESV, we can get into that. And I'll read verses 17 down through 26. 1 Corinthians 17, 9-26. But in the following instructions, ESV, great Bibles if you have them. But in the following instructions, I do not commend you because you come together. It is not for better, but for worse. So this is not starting off good. Paul is instructing the church at Corinth, who had a knowledge of the death and resurrection of Jesus, but were sort of missing the mark with some of his ordinances. Okay? Whenever my boss calls me into his office and he says first, I say, oh, Lord, here we go. he's about to hit me with several. Either he's really mad and he's written all the same things down in steps, or he actually does have several points of trouble for me. And it happens sometimes because, you know, if you're really working hard anywhere, you're going to make mistakes. Amen. If you want to not be offended, if you want to not offend nobody, if you don't want nobody to talk about you, if you don't want nobody to critique you, say nothing, do nothing, and stand up for nothing. And that's exactly how that will happen. But when you have a mind to stand up for something, yes, have some spiritual backbone, yes, decide to live the life that you are being called to live, that's going to be some trouble. Mm-hmm. Everybody ain't for life.
Amen.
Amen. So first place, when you come together in the church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part, for there must be factions. Look, I'm not actually, this is not ad lib. This is what the Bible says. This is what God is teaching us. There has to be factions in the church. Mm-hmm. There has to be factions.
Right.
There has to be some sections in the church. There has to be some divisions in the church. And this is why he says in verse 19, so that those who are genuine may be recognized.
Yeah.
Mm. See, he said that is sometimes you can hide in a group. Last few months ago, I came into a different area, and I was a person with a less seniority, and all the rest of the people there had much time in. And sometimes when there's someone of a babe in the area or someone who's unlearned, you can hide because of all their trouble. You know, they're spending so much time trying to fix Johnny and get Johnny's point up that sometimes the other people have tendency to hide. But in the church, it's good that we have factions because we need to know as pastors, as leaders, and you need to know who's truly genuine. Who's genuine? Yes. Because everyone who comes to church, unfortunately, is not genuinely concerned about their salvation or their growth. Amen. Amen. That's just right off the Bible. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry and another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received the Lord what I delivered to you. I received from the Lord what I am delivered to you. That the Lord, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread.
Yes.
And when he had gained thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Look at somebody and say, this is for me. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you think, as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Yes.
Amen. I want to just teach a little bit this afternoon, this morning, about the body that is broken for you.
Yes.
The body broken for you. And with the subtitle, maybe, the blood of the new covenant. The blood of the new agreement. Okay? So in Christ, we have a new agreement. We have a new deal. I don't know which president, maybe Teddy Roosevelt or somebody did the new deal, but it's nice sometimes to have a new deal. General Motors, we're currently ending some contracts, and we'll have a new deal there, and some people will be happy, and some people won't. Amen. But I'm happy about this new covenant. Anybody happy about this new deal we have with God? Because the church in Corinth had the long history, and it was a different time then, But some of the stuff transfers right into this church and to this people and to our thinking right now. So they had a long-standing history of the law, of the strict regimen of if you do this, you get that. And it was a quid pro quo. If you do it, you'll be blessed. And if you don't, you'll be cursed. Remember that? Moses told them that coming out of Egypt.
Yes.
The problem was none of them could keep it.
Amen.
613 laws. I could, even as a pastor, anybody here can read the Ten Commandments off the top of your head right now? So I know it's going to be hard for you to do 613 because you don't know 613. And you don't know Ten Commandments, how could you know 613? So they had this strict law before. And like the rest of everyone who lived before them acting, they couldn't really keep it. So when we come into the church today and our teaching has to set up the same way, we transfer it to 2000 AD or 70 AD, right here to 2022. And we say, we have this strict law we couldn't keep. So now we have this new covenant that is ratified by the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
He wants you to know that this deal was made. When they make deals in Congress, the men come together. They got the Republicans over here. They got the Democrats over here. And some days they carry on, sister. And some days they yell and scream. And some days the guy up here will go on and on. And they bang that gavel. And then after a while, after many months, that bill will become a law. But when it comes to our faith, there was no deliberation. There was no Democrats, there wasn't Republicans. The apostles didn't get to vote. The prophets didn't get to have to say. The pastors didn't weigh in. Isaiah said he looked to his left, and there was no one. He looked to his right, and there was none to behold. He said, but my own arm brought me salvation. Hallelujah. That the deal was foreordained before we got here, that Christ should suffer for our sins. Hallelujah. And the teaching today lets us know that it is in his blood that we have atonement. In his blood that we have forgiveness. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Forgiveness of sin. In that same blood, we have power, strength, joy, and all those wonderful things that we enjoy today. So let's just touch a few principal points here. What is communion? Communion is the Lord's Supper. It is an opportunity for us to remember and celebrate the sacrifice of Jesus.
Yes.
When I opened today, I talked about what was the primary reason a grandma still goes to work or a mama goes to work. It isn't because the job is so great. There's guys harassing her and people bothering her. And they get mistreated and looked over. The primary reason they go is for the children. I'm going to put something on their back. I'm going to put something on their shoes or something good on their plate. Christmas time comes. They're going to have some gifts. And Easter comes. These kids are going to be dressed up like they love the Lord. Amen. So the primary reason Paul is really pushing toward us that we come to church and that we serve God is to always remember the suffering and the death of Jesus. A lot of times we put and place our service in the church and in the community based on how we've been treated or what we think of a pastor or how we think of a particular community or how our theology has been shaped. Whoa! I want you to consider this morning that the very root of what we do in our service to God is based on the fact that his body was broken and that his blood was given. That the bread that came down from life, the two-on human form, suffered, he bled and he died for our sin.
Amen.
And that the new agreement, the new covenant that we have, our acceptance to God, is based on the fact that Christ died, that he was buried, and God raised him up.
Amen.
Can I get amen this morning?
Amen.
So, this is to be an eternal sacrament or religious act. And we are going to make sure we keep that going here. This is our first communion here today, okay? 1 Corinthians 11:26, as we pointed out, as often as you do this. Now, I love the Bible, and I love the Lord, because he doesn't put us on such a strict regimen of when you ought to be doing it, and bam, bam, bam. But I think it's important that it is a scheduled and a regular thing. So we're going to try to do better with being scheduled and regular, okay? The Bible doesn't really point out how frequently, So we won't be so dogmatic as to tell you that we have to do this, that you have to do this, but you ought to do this.
Yes.
As often as you do it. You may not be able to make every communion, but you need to be taking communion. Okay?
Yes.
How can I prepare my heart for communion? I've always believed it's wise to spend a time and a moment in prayer. Bishop has taught well that we need to teach on the importance and the reason for communion. Why do we take it? Before. That's good. Well, what we ought to also do is reflect. Remember, in this same chapter, he says, I received from the Lord what I passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had gave thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. And he did the same thing with the blood. This is the cup of the new covenant. It is in my blood. And whenever you drink it, remember me. Okay? So the beauty of taking communion is it is the opportunity to reflect on the great sacrifice that was made for our salvation. These elements are designed to be an eternal reminder of the price that God paid for our redemption. If you recall, Peter said, don't you know that it was not perishable days that you were born that saved you, but by the precious blood of Jesus as a lamb without spot. It's possible to come to church and go through the motions and sort of look at the lights and look at what people's wearing and trying to figure out what my favorite song is, but occasionally God wants us to remember the cross. He wants us to remember his suffering as a pinpoint or the main reason, not why I get up and go to work because I love the kids, but why you serve the Lord, why you worship him, why you love him, because he gave his life. Now, when I was younger, we had an issue with the text because it says, if any man later on, if any man takes this unworthily, if any person takes this unworthily, and we have people, and I'll tell you what, I've been struggling hard, so keep praying. We have people in this church who don't want to take communion because they think they're unworthy. But when you finally get saved for real, for real, for real, you know you ain't worthy.
Right.
You won't guess. You know you ain't worthy. They still got pride up in them. They try to say, oh, I'll fix it this week. What you gonna fix? How you gonna fix it? You tell me. Because there wasn't no need for him to die and suffer the worst death, the worst suffering that ever was, and to shed his blood. He didn't have no need to shed his blood or spotless, the clean blood. But Peter said there was no guile in his mouth. And he didn't have a bad thought going. He didn't even stir up the same that nasty. But he gave his life for you and I. So when it says that if any man takes it unworthily, it's not talking about some sort of self-righteous form whereby I feel even if you're stuck in a sinful path, hey, get up here and reflect on what you've been doing. Give God praise for what he did and thank him for what he's done. Because his blood is powerful to wash away any sin. Not some sin, all sin. Somebody say amen to that. So we are encouraged this morning to reflect on what God did. He gave his only begotten son, not so we could sit up here with a pompous attitude or an attitude like, I finally made it. No, he made it for me.
Yes.
He brought me to this point and he did it through his suffering.
Yes.
This is my body that was broken for you.
Amen.
You recall, I always press on the three G's of salvation, from Gabbatha to Golgotha.
Yes.
I didn't miss the one G. But there's three G's of salvation where his body was broken. The Gabbatha was the pavement where they tied him to a rock and they beat his back and then they took him to Golgotha. Okay? So we always are to remember, because Simeon, that's right, thank you. I've got some Bible readers in here. The three G's of salvation. Prayer is a rough thing. When we come in here, it's not easy for us to get started. I try not to just watch. I try to participate, but I see it's not always easy for us to get going in the mornings in prayer.
Yes.
It's like the Spirit of God usually typically works slow, and this is we sort of work out the kinks in our necks and things, and begin to consider the goodness of God.
Yes.
You know, but in the same manner, we ought to examine ourselves, not in a manner where we're judging ourselves in a harsh way and trying to fix ourselves when God has already done the work.
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 11:28 says in our same text, examine themselves before they eat the bread and drink from the cup. Everyone ought to examine yourself. This is what I'm doing. Is my life lined up with his sacrifice?
Yes.
Is what I'm doing on a daily basis and how I'm living my life lined up with my appreciation and the remembrance of Christ's death?
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Because there's such a pull to go do what I want to do. I don't want to come to church. I want to set my feet in front of the fire. Feels so good. Got some movies lined up, and it's just not my Sunday. But when God said, remember the Sabbath, keep it holy, said, because this is what he said. This was the reason. That was the reason why he went to work. So because he did it for the kid. He said, remember, you were a slave in Egypt.
Yes.
I don't want you to talk about how good the Savior is, because sometimes Pastor Dave's often, he can't always preach real good. But that's not why I'm in service. Remember, you was a slave in Egypt. And again, somebody said, I was never in Egypt. He's talking about your slave to sin. Sin. There was a time where you were a slave to sin. You may sin now, it's on your own volition. But there was a time where you didn't have, you let it rip. I don't know when it was. Some of us got, the Spirit moved in us at 16. Some of us was 10. Some of us was 40. It don't really matter. But whenever it was God that moved. He broke us from the bondage of sin. That's why we sing that song, Freedom.
Amen.
Because he, the Son, said, free is free indeed. We remember that.
Yes.
We remember that. We examine ourselves to say, is my life and lifestyle bearing witness to my mouth?
Yes.
Am I walking what I'm talking?
Yes.
And there's nothing wrong with that. But we need to make sure at all times we are examining our own selves to see if we're in the faith.
Yes.
Okay? Another point, principal point was that the other part of communion should be rejoicing. This is a day not to be sad. This is a day of rejoicing, okay, for what Christ did. It should not make us super somber, but it should cause us to rejoice. He has forgiven us of our sins. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
Put your hands together. Put my sins up again. All of them. What you want to do, what you did do, what you think about doing, what you should have did, what you could have did. It's all under the blood. This is a time to rejoice. This is our Christian faith. So when we get ready to take communion a little bit and you chew some of that bread in your mouth, just chew it up with a smile on your face. Who in the world would not be happy about their sins being forgiven? We have a different attitude when I was growing up. You know, we were so serious to the point where we couldn't enjoy it, but Paul was pointing out that they actually were coming together, they were supposed to have a good time, they were drinking a little bit of wine, apparently, but some of them was drinking too much, and they were making a mess. In the Christian life, it's always control is the issue. Control is always the problem, even when it comes to having a partner. God wants you to have a partner, but with the right partner. In the right confines of a marriage. They screw tape letters. C.S. Lewis' screw tape letter says it's the purpose of the devil to get us to take the right things at the wrong time with the wrong people. And that's what we've done in the church. We have twisted it up and took the right things and made them wrong. No, we just appear to promote them. We're not supposed to take the right thing at the wrong time with the wrong people. Amen. So in the wrong measurements.
Yes.
And that's what he's pointing out here. They were probably drinking a little too much. They were Christians, drinking too much. And then on top of that, he said some people, when they would come together, they would bring these feasts together, and some people were leaving with their belly poking out. And then other folks wasn't eating. They were forgetting the love and the care and the tenderness that we're supposed to have in the church. Oh, I can preach on that. They were forgetting the love and the care and the tenderness we're supposed to have in the church. Oh, since giving the wine and the sacrament, shoot that stuff up. No, you're missing the point. He gave his life So when we come together, that love and tenderness and care is supposed to be present all the time. Now, we don't become any different than Apple or General Motors or some sort of big business. We're just all just doing our business to go home. But he wanted them to say, hey, remember, let's have some order here, okay? And make sure everyone is fed. Make sure everybody has what they need. That's why I encourage you, don't just run out of everything. But God might talk to you. And tell you, slide somebody a 10. Slide somebody a 20. So don't be afraid to come to God's house with $5 or $6. Don't be afraid to be a blessing to somebody. I'm just teaching as plain as I can this morning about the Lord's Supper and what some of the issues were. So if we get to the point where we're taking communion and we're doing it on a regular basis, but we don't keep in mind the significance of it, then we're missing the mark. And it becomes sort of just a vain sacrament that we're doing. Okay? Communion is a wonderful time to remind yourself what is most important. It's easy to get off track about what is actually really important. This is one of the biggest issues in the Christian life, prioritizing. And I've got to the point in my life where I'm pretty good at it. So if you call me up and ask me to go do something next week, the chances is about no. Because God is always telling me ahead of time what I need to be doing. And it used to be when someone could tell me something, I said, oh, can I go? But now the Lord has shown me that there ain't no fruit there. So even they may get mad and they may get upset, but it'll bless them and it's going to glorify me because you did what I asked you to do. Okay? So communion is a great time to remind ourselves what is really important in life. Sometimes you can have a great job that pays well and you decide, you know what? I'd rather be doing this job that doesn't pay much at all, but I get to see this little kid smiling face every day. And it's such a blessing to me. And the extra money I've gotten has been more than a burden. And everybody needs something all of a sudden. But you know what? It gives us an opportunity to just give some reflection on what is really important. That's what communion does. Okay? Is the things that I've allowed to creep in my life more important than the peace that I had before when I walked up right before God?
Yes.
That's one of the things we should reflect on this morning. Remember, we're taking out that unworthy part. Unworthy has went out the door. He's down in Ball State somewhere, down there with Darwinism and evolution and all that other things they teach. But here we accept the fact that we will examine ourselves. Okay?
Yes.
So this is the opportunity to reflect. What's important in your life? Is there anyone who should go? And there is someone who should come in. It's easy to get sidetracked by things going on around us. But when we come to the time of communion, it should start being very clear what God wants from us. Okay, so that's one of the things I want you to consider this morning. Okay? Now, I've got three principal points that I want to share with you about the text. And I think they're important. One, the basis of what Paul has said is history and not dogmatism. It's important in the church to, as you share the gospel, and if you go somewhere and you hear the gospel, that you can recognize what we call dogmatism. And that is putting or trying to express an idea or belief that has no evidence. I can't share something that doesn't have any evidence. A lot of times people will tell me, and I would go to a church somewhere, and I guess someone would call themselves holiness church, a different thing. And after they told me that, they'd be right, I said, well, where is that in the Bible? They said, well, it's in there. I said, where? Oh, it's in there. Where's that? Because I got Google and everything. Just tell me where it's at. Because I can get it right away. And they can't tell you nothing. I can't express or I can't teach anything that's not in the Bible. Do you hear what I'm saying? No Reconstruction, one of my great writers, I forget her name, Paula Friedrichsen. She said, no Reconstruction of the Bible, no matter how splendid it is, if it doesn't speak to what actually happened in the Bible, it fails as history. Okay, so what Paul was taking them back, he says, I want you to remember this point in time that was not Hansel and Gretel. This is not some fictional story. Point number one is this is history. This actually happened. Christ took the bread and he broke it.
And if we go back before that time, and we go back after that time, he gave his life. When we have the actual factual data that Jesus Christ lived, that the miracle worker lived. It was 2,000 years ago, but he was here.
Yes.
And that he gave his life, that he suffered, and that same Jesus died on the cross. He died a painful, suffering death that was absolutely 100% certain. Matter of fact, when people died on the cross, they wrote the writ of death before the person was on the cross. That's how certain it was that that person was going to die. It was no joke. It wasn't a two-box situation where is he dead? He's a gone. He's as good as gone. And so our death was written at the cross in a spiritual sense. And when Christ died, we was risen with him. And we came up anew. Just how they rejoiced that he was seen by the three and the apostles and the 12 and then the 500. That we ought to rejoice today because Christ is risen today. We are risen with him today. We ought to give God praise. It's time to rejoice. You ought to be happy this morning. Hallelujah. That he gave his life. And it is an actual, factual time of history. That's why we got these Bibles here. That's why it's the best-selling book of all time. It's not some fictional thing. Paul says, I want you to remember this time in history. When Christ, before he died, he took that bread and said, this is my body. He hadn't died yet. He hadn't suffered yet. But that was to come that was broken for you. It was broken for me. And for very reasons, the Bible says that he became sin that knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Somebody say hallelujah. So number one, it is an actual fact. It's not dogma. It's not some teaching. It's forced. If you want to go get data, there are places all over the community where you can go get actual facts. Amen. You can get the property details of a property and when it sold, what year it sold, and what they sold it for.
Yes.
And those are, and the same way, Paul wants you to know that this is not a fictional story. That Jesus died on the cross. And that he left it know that I want this to be an eternal sacrament. Because I want you to remember, I want you to reflect on why you're doing what you're doing.
Amen.
Number two, it forces readers, it's forcing us back to the upper room. It's good sometimes to go back to a time in history. I don't particularly like people that are constantly nostalgic. You remember back in the 86 and we did this? I said, no, I'm actually trying to forget that. I'm trying to forget that. And some people always want to pull you back to a time where you weren't doing right. Or where you didn't have so much. So why did they do that? I don't know. You know, or a time where you struggled. You know, oh, I remember he just treated you so bad, girl. I don't need to hear that. You know, don't take me back there. I don't need to know. But there are some times where we ought to go back. And this is one of those times today. We got to remember the upper room. When the Lord told them to wait in the upper room there in the principal city of Jerusalem, wait on the promised Holy Spirit. And that God was going to have one more supper with them. At that time, he would explain to them through type and symbolic by taking the bread and breaking it, the things that he was about to do with his body on the cross as the Passover lamb. So that the words that John said when he first said, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. So these names would come together in theology and said, yesterday I'm free from the penalty of sin. I'm free from the bondage of sin. One day I'll be free from the presence of sin because of what God has done. And we have reason to rejoice here today.
Amen.
He wants us to take us back to the cross, back to the Calvary, and back to his suffering and what it actually meant. So that we might, even in rough times, have reason to rejoice.
Amen.
He wants them to know it's part of history. He wants to take them back to the actual thing. And lastly, he wants them to delineate that what the Lord did was real and we cannot escape the significance of it. And it's important to consider today that we thank God for the new covenant. We thank God because we are not living under the law, but we are living under the free liberty that Jesus Christ has given us. And as you grow in grace to God, You grow in love for God. And if you see somebody who has a great love for God and for people, you have witnessed somebody who has a great understanding of the Bible. And you won't have a great understanding of the Bible until you can understand that love and understanding go right together. And then we become accepted to people who aren't necessarily like us, who don't necessarily do what we do. We're not talking about conforming. I'm talking about love. God did not call us to conform, but he's called us to love everybody. And there's nothing wrong with love. God is love. And he exhibited that love when he hung Jesus out on the old rugged cross. That day when he became the sin bearer for all of our sins and gave his life, the Bible says that when he was reviled, he didn't revile back. They spit on him, he didn't spit back. And they yelled at him, and he didn't yell back, but he willingly gave his life. The Bible says he could have called 12 legions of angels and stopped it all, but he didn't do it because of the great love that he had. This is his body that was broken for you this morning. Whatever you're going through, you ought to say thank God this morning. Because there's more than just salvation there. There's joy in his broken body. There is healing in the broken body of Jesus this morning. There's peace in the broken body of Jesus. When I think of his suffering and what he did, and I consider Isaiah 53 that says, who shall believe his report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He shall grow up as a tender plant and a root out of a dry ground. Hallelujah. The Bible goes on to say that he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of my peace was upon him. I need peace this morning. And by his stripes, I'm healed this morning. Whatever you need, God has it this morning. Thank God for that broken body of Jesus. Hallelujah. I remember when he approached Thomas, and Thomas doubted him. He said, look at the nails in my hands. But he was risen, and God has seated him at the right hand of the magistrate on high this morning. I'm talking about my God and your God and our God, and we ought to rejoice today because we have a great and wonderful Savior. Somebody say amen this morning. This is my body, broken for you. Broken for you. So if his body was broken for you, you ought to give God praise. You ought to give God thanks. I want everyone to come up to the first four rows, if you would, please, from the back. Come on up. Come on up. Very good. Come on up. Fill the first five rows. Come on up, we won't keep it going on. We do want to be ceremonious. Come on up. Come on up. We're going to remember that Jesus paid it all this morning. And all to him we owe. Now come on up from the back. Come on up. It won't hurt you. Come on up here. Come on up. We want to remember what Jesus did. Hallelujah. We want to remember the cup of the testament. Yes, hold out there. You grab some of those. Two for you. Don't open it yet. Don't open it yet. Pass those down. We want you to remember the most important thing about your faith is not tachikos. The most important thing about your faith is passing away. The most important thing about your faith is not you. Pass those down. It's all sealed up, so you shouldn't have to worry about COVID. We got some hand sanitizer. Sweetie, will you go back and get the hand sanitizer? Some of us shook hands. Go get the hand sanitizer. We don't want to say you got COVID from Maria. Get you some sanitizer. Everybody got one? Everybody got one? You got one? Everybody got one? Thank you. Amen. You got one? Everybody got one. Raise your hand if you need one. Remember, this is a commandment from the Lord. This isn't a suggestion. Coming here and not taking communion, you might not come back here. Amen. Anyone need to come back here? If you can't accept the blood of Jesus to die for your sin, maybe they got somewhere else that somebody died for you. You see, maybe Muhammad didn't give his life for you. I don't think so. You are a sinner in God's grace, and it's been provided by the blood of Jesus. And let me just share something with you. I'm open to you. So the Catholics believe, and God bless them, they believe that when we eat this and do this, it is actually the blood of Jesus. But I promise you, this is going to taste like grape juice. And that bread cracker was made somewhere in Indiana. This is not going to transform magically into something that it's not. The Bible points out that it's symbolic in the book of John. He lets us know this is a symbol. This isn't a magic hocus pocus. We do this as symbolic. Okay? Just like we take oil each week, we take the oil. The oil does not become something new when we put it on your head. It's symbolic of the Holy Spirit, all in the Bible. There are some things we don't throw away. James says, if anybody's sick among you, let him call on the elders. Let him anoint you with oil. And the prayer, faith, will save the sick. Not the oil. But the oil shows that we're obedient. Do what God said to do. Same reason why we get baptized. We know baptism don't save. H2O don't save. But it's a sign of obedience. Christ, a sign that Christ went down into death. In the same way, we symbolically would die with him. Galatians 2:20. I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Life I live now, I live by faith. So this is a symbolic thing. And Bishop, would you come? I'm going to sit down with First Lady, and I'm going to let you lead us through this. If you need the Bible or anything, this is sort of impromptu, but I wanted you to come up. Let me get this for you.
Say amen.
Amen.
I'd like to skip down to verse 23. Pastor John has already instructed us and given us points, the importance of communion or the Lord's Supper. And some call it the Eucharist also. And it's very important. It's not optional, but it's something that we do. Amen. In remembrance of him.
Yes.
Not only we remember him, but there is the evidence and facts in there that he's coming back again.
Amen.
Amen. So we have hope in Jesus. Hope that one day we're going to be with him.
Yes.
And we don't have to suffer.
Hallelujah.
Amen. As we do in this life. Beloved, I'll tell you that as members of the body of Christ, we deal with things.
Yes.
We have loved ones who pass away.
Yes.
Whether it's our parents, whether it's siblings, whether it's a child. And so with all these things that we deal with in life, we have a Savior, a Lord and a God who cares. So let's go to verse 23, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus on the same night when he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So we're doing it, number one, to remember him. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So let us get ready to do this.
And we take it by faith.
Yes.
Anything not of faith is sin.
he took bread and he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. You do it in remembrance of me. So let's take the body together in Jesus' name. Good man of the house. The master had need of this place. Amen. In the upper room. All right. Now let's drink it. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. All right. So let's drink it in Jesus' name together.
In
Jesus'
name,
amen.
Y'all
get
it away
from me. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, the scripture is one of the gospel lines. I think it's Mark. It said they sang a hymn and they went out into the Mount of Olives. If we don't have the Mount of Olives to go into, that's over and around Jerusalem. But we have our places to go. Amen. So I want to call on our pastor this time.
Amen.
He can go from this point on. Is that right?
Amen.
Amen. Let's say amen.
Come on, say it with me. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Say, Sister Darnette, can I get you to come and help with the offering this morning?
So bring a friend, bring yourself and bring a friend and tell them to come and eat. We want them here in Berea this week to enjoy some good fellowship and some good food. Amen. Right at 10 o'clock, we'll have the tables downstairs. And we're going to enjoy some good food. So at this time, if you have something to give, we ask that you stand and come. I'm sorry, Sister Gardner and Sister Lynette is First Lady Lynette is going to share something.
I just wanted to remind you all that today is the day that we were supposed to set aside a little something soft to give to our pastor. If you haven't already, some already gave him a little token of love for pastors or clergy appreciation month this month. So if Sister Niecy, raise your hand, Sister Niecy, she's going to take the offering for our pastor. But if you have something that you wanted to put in the church offering, maybe your tithes or something like that, Minister Darnell, will you raise your hand? She is going to receive the offering. After offering, I do have a few announcements, so please don't leave right away. I do have some announcements for the ladies as well, so I will leave it now for offering. And you can enter from the rear and come around.
Thank you to all those that were able to give, and we pray for those that had a desire to give but did not have. As Pastor Lee has already said, just remind you to come next Saturday. We want to see everybody and your friends and family that can come. Those that you want to invite, please do that. There are still a few items left to sign up, so if you haven't signed up or just signed up for a little, maybe you can stretch yourself and sign up for a little bit more, or sign up to serve or to help clean up or something. So look at that list out on the table outside the two doors if you would do that. Do not forget, on Wednesday at what time?
6 o'clock.
We have what?
Bible
study every Sunday at
10
a.m. We have Sunday morning worship. So please come and invite someone to be with you. Those that don't have a church home or those that are seeking, we'd love to have them come. Amen?
Amen.
I want to talk to the ladies after Bible study on Wednesday briefly. I met with a few of you all after church about 2 weeks ago regarding a women's ministry that we're calling Her Story for His Glory. For women that are going through, that have been hurt, traumatized, and that we as a body want to minister to them about forgiveness and loving, and so they can release, let go, and move on. Amen? How many believe in healing and deliverance? And so we want that for women and men alike, but this is our women's ministry, and I want each and every one of you women that are here and are available, when we have this meeting, it'll be once a month, so hopefully it's not too much out of your time or day, but we want to be praying and fasting, and I want to meet with you because I want everybody to be a part. Is that all right, ladies? Can you give me about 20 minutes, 15 minutes after Bible study for that? Just a short time. And if you can't come to Bible study, if you already have something going on this Wednesday, meet with me today before you leave. Amen? Amen. Amen. God bless you. Back in the hands of Pastor Lee.
Okay, we're going to dismiss this morning. You stand. Thank God for each one of you. Hope you were blessed this morning by communion. Everyone with uplifted hands, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Okay, hug someone, tell them you love them.
Amen.
I've been wanting to just kind of get busy.